if there was an earthquake in the Bay Area and all of our internet centers were shut down, you know, and we had no internet, what would we do? Well, people would come to us and say, you guys are smart, you'll figure it out. So our idea is to start figuring it out right now. So the internet we know right now is a vast penetrated attack surface. The internet has been attacked by .com cookie stalkers, by governments surveilling everything, and by criminals penetrating our enterprises. So we've got to begin to think about new architectures for the internet. So this is the sixth of a series of talks that we have had at IFTF, exploring new ways to think about internet architectures. And so tonight, I'm truly delighted to have Eric Klinker join us from the BitTorrent. BitTorrent, as you know, some of you probably know, and Eric will tell us more about BitTorrent, but BitTorrent is the actual commercial products division of the Torrent software community. So they make products that the rest of us can use for safe distributed computing that is not necessarily vulnerable to the commercial, government, or criminal observance of our activities. And so without further ado, it's my great pleasure to present Eric Klinker, the Chief Executive Officer of BitTorrent, who's going to talk to us about the next internet.
Well, thank you for having me this evening. It's obviously a wonderful pleasure to be here with you, and the opportunity to talk a little bit about how we see the future of the internet, I think, is something that's not to be missed. And you know, we have a unique perspective, perhaps. We don't look like too many properties out there on the internet today. We don't look like too many properties that are even venture-backed today, and we are venture-backed. I'll talk about that as well. So, you know, let me just jump right in and talk a little bit about properties that we would like to see in the internet of the future. And these are core principles for us, and they're not always core principles for everybody that is building applications on the internet. But you know, if we could, whether it's the internet of the past, the present, or the future, we would like to see an internet that's open and neutral. That's a bit of a loaded term, and one that can scale for almost anything that we could imagine using it for. And as the internet becomes the dominant platform for content consumption, you can imagine the kind of scale that's going to be required of it soon. And the internet we have today isn't really designed for that, and probably won't be able to do that without some help, and maybe help from BitTorrent. So you might ask, well, Netflix works. Doesn't the internet work for content? And I think network neutrality is solved, or at least I've been told that. So is this vision really even necessary? And we believe that, here and there, maybe there are solutions that exist, but if you're in some parts of the world where the kind of streaming architectures that Netflix delivers just don't work, this is not true. And if you're in some parts of the world where maybe the policy solutions aren't so favorable, this is obviously not true as well. So perhaps it is important to think about how we could bake these principles into an architecture that would deliver on those core principles I just mentioned. And I think to illustrate perhaps why this might still be a problem that we want to think about, we need to go back in time a little bit to maybe a different network. One that predated the internet, one that was highly centralized and tightly controlled. And by its centralized nature, it was closed. And innovation was very difficult on this network. In fact, it was hardly any innovation at all. This network went unchanged for 100 years, for the most part. And ultimately, there came a time when this network was replaced by the internet. And this was a glorious network. It was distributed, fully distributed. The power lived at the edge of this network. It was peer-to-peer in origin. For those of you who are back on it, academics talking to other academics, peer-to-peer. This was the original architecture that thrived on the internet. It's what made the internet very powerful. Also, the internet, in a way, rejected many of the closed online communities that we tried to put on it, right? This is why the internet exists and things like AOL and CompuServe don't. Open will win if given the opportunity, at least I believe it will. So this network was great, but it's not really the network we have today, if you think about it. The cloud, what we think of the cloud, in quotes, today is really something that doesn't look like that original vision.
It doesn't look like it at all. Inside the cloud, you have many different services. They are almost always proprietary, tightly controlled stacks of applications. The user has less and less power in the cloud. The power that lived on the consumer edge of the early internet doesn't really exist today, at least on one side of the spectrum. And because of this, and because this is an environment where you see the irresistible urge to centralize, and especially if in among the venture-backed community, with centralization come obvious benefits. If you're a business, it comes power, and with power, you know, comes ultimately profit. So you can understand why this is happening. But if you're really dystopian and you think about where it might go, right? Think about the future, and you know, maybe there comes a day when this trend continues to the point where we wake up and we think about the network we left behind, and it's the same network we have today, no different than the phone network. So imagine everything you use on the internet, and if you look under the surface of that application and you think about how that application or that service is being delivered, you'll find almost always something tightly, highly centralized. Not necessarily in a way that's good for the user, but you can also, you might appreciate the irony that on top of this beautiful decentralized blessing of an architecture that the early internet fathers gave us, we have built applications that look, for all intents and purposes, like the phone network, where innovation isn't perhaps permitted, and where they are in complete control of these applications. So perhaps this isn't the future that we want. Perhaps this isn't the future that made the internet great. And if you start to see innovation slowing down on the internet, it might be because of some of these trends. Okay, so that's maybe a little bit of a problem statement. So BitTorrent is a company that has a different mission. We look at this as an opportunity to say, perhaps there's another way to do this. Perhaps we can use the power of decentralized technology to undo some of that damage, and to put into place, into the commercial market, applications where the users have more control. This is what we think made the internet great to begin with, and perhaps it can again. So this is BitTorrent's mission, and you can see some of the billboards that we've put up from time to time, where we, in many ways, prod at some of the problems that we see out on the internet, whether those problems are surveillance, which took some guts, or whether it, you know, is solutions like this, where perhaps, you know, people should determine where the internet goes and not perhaps some big corporation or some policy group. So you guys probably know how the internet or how the BitTorrent protocol works. I won't waste time on that. Of course, a very decentralized protocol. It is in our DNA. We seem like we would be the right people to bring this vision about if there is such an opportunity for this vision. Because it's what we've always done. We've always built networks that are inherently decentralized. Almost nothing we do is centralized in nature. We believe in no servers anywhere. And as close as we can get to that vision, the better. Why is this powerful? Again, I'll lose my phone. The vision is powerful, you know, for all kinds of obvious reasons as well, right? It brings about an efficiency that's difficult to replicate. If you think about the sharing economy that's quite popular today, you know, BitTorrent is really an early version of the sharing economy for assets on the internet that are going unused, and we're simply harnessing those resources, those assets, and putting together a system that is impossible to replicate in a centralized manner. If you took all the CDNs on the planet and put them all together, the capacity that exists inside BitTorrent is many, many times that entire capability. So we believe, as you imagine a system that has, you know, something like fixed cost and infinite ability to deliver content, this looks very much like the broadcast networks that predated the internet, and they're very efficient for delivering content, versus the Netflix model or a YouTube model or stream by stream by stream. You have something like a linear cost associated with that. And it is, you know, if you just do some back of the envelope math and try to replicate all of the television that is watched over the air or on cable, and think about, well, what if I try to deliver that on the internet the way Netflix does? You would need to deliver something like 66 exabytes of data a month. And that might cost you about $5 billion in a CDN bill, or you might need to build about 10 to 20 nuclear power plants just to keep the servers cold. So not a model that's likely to scale anytime soon. And we think, therefore, if the internet is to scale for content, and especially as the trends in content are going in one direction only, more and more high fidelity, this is a problem that ultimately will catch up with us. It hasn't yet, but perhaps soon. So again, back to that challenge. Anything that makes the internet valuable for you, imagine what it is. And at BitTorrent, we look at those applications and we think, there's an opportunity here. Can I reimagine that application in a completely decentralized way? Can I imagine a social network where there were no servers? Could I imagine a messaging or a Twitter-like application where there was no censorship? Could I imagine email that was difficult to spy on? Could I imagine search where all of my search history wasn't being stored and aggregated and then advertising sold against? I think these are all the opportunities that we see for decentralized architectures to perhaps once again reimagine how the internet could be useful for me. And that's the way BitTorrent looks at it. And we, you know, that's a big landscape, right? I mean, these are all gigantic companies and we're, you know, 150 people. How are we going to do that? Well, you know, we're going to start with one application at a time. The BitTorrent protocol, everybody knows it. But, you know, one of the first opportunities we saw is, well, what if we took Dropbox or any of these cloud storage services and rendered them without the cloud? And that's where BitTorrent Sync, or Sync by BitTorrent, originated from. It is a completely cloudless service. It looks very much like Dropbox to the user. It has exactly the same look and feel. It delivers exactly the same value proposition. It just does it without the cloud. And it does it without the NSA. And it does it without a lot of other things that might come with the cloud that you might not want. Lock-in, right? If Dropbox went away, what happens to my data? Could I even get a terabyte out of Dropbox in time before it was gone? If BitTorrent goes away tomorrow, BitTorrent Sync keeps working. And that is also something that is important to keep in mind. It is power at the edge of the network, and it's completely private. It's completely in your hands. So this is just one application, and it has other benefits as well. You know, we can promote the ability to move data at LAN speed. The BitTorrent protocol, of course, is very efficient for big objects. So if you're a graphic designer or you need to move big data around, you're probably already using BitTorrent and you know what it can do. This is a perfect application for you. Or if you're highly regulated and can't use the cloud, you're academic or you're in finance or you're a lawyer or you're in healthcare. These are all opportunities for a cloudless future. So become a cloud cutter is my motto. Cut the cloud, use BitTorrent Sync. So other applications for decentralized communication. Communication is clearly one of the most powerful forms of, or one of the more powerful applications on the internet. It's, I think it's one of the things that, you know, as a early user of the internet, I found most compelling. I grew up on a farm, almost in complete isolation. I have no social skills as a result, but you can imagine my astounding surprise where I could connect with almost anybody instantaneously over this network called the internet, and how amazing that was. Email, early versions of chat and talk, these were very powerful concepts to me. Unfortunately, they were all, or at least nowadays, they're all almost completely rendered through the cloud. And sometimes they're secured in quotes, because the metadata isn't, right? These services know who talks to who, and with that metadata, you can glean quite a bit of information, enough to, you know, do all kinds of things with. BitTorrent Bleep is an application that doesn't have that problem. It is completely peer-to-peer. It's a SIP engine that's distributed, so every client has an embedded SIP server in it. Complete end-to-end encryption. We rotate keys quite frequently. It's very, very secure. And because it's completely decentralized, I have no idea who is talking to whom. And we just took this out of beta last week, and so far so good. It looks like it's finding an interesting niche here and there. So if you're interested in communications where you're not interested in other people knowing about it, or it might just be incognito, or you might want to connect with people that you don't know their personal identifying information, this is an application that allows you to address all of those needs. And I was invited here to talk about the browser, and I haven't yet talked about the browser. So one more application, and then I'll get to Maelstrom, which is the product that I think we're most interested in. But This is a new protocol that Bram invented about 7 years ago. It took him 7 years to create this protocol. It is, for all intents and purposes, a linear version of BitTorrent. You could think of it like a peer-to-peer Meerkat or a peer-to-peer Periscope. With all the problems that Periscope and Meerkat are stumbling into with copyright, obviously we are not the brand to carry that application forward. So we have been keeping this one relatively closed and trying to attract interest from the very tippity top of the content pyramid. Because we're interested in promoting the idea that peer-to-peer is a superior architecture for all content, even content that you want to protect in a way. So sports is perhaps the ultimate in content, in the content ecosystem. It's the most valuable. It's very ephemeral. It loses value very quickly. So copyright infringement isn't much of an issue for it. Therefore, we think it's a perfect application for a peer-to-peer architecture to begin to address. And Bram was interested in attacking a couple of problems here. The first was very low latency. He wanted these streams to be viewable with less than 5 seconds of latency. And for those of you who watch the Super Bowl online and also happen to be watching it on cable, you might have noticed that there was about a minute to 90 seconds of latency between cable to online. And that just doesn't work for sports, right? You're going to get the tweet before you see the touchdown, or you have to isolate yourself from the internet and watch the game. So this is a problem that we think we're uniquely qualified to address technically, but where the problem has become here is, you know, how does BitTorrent, a tiny little company like this, take a product like OnAir to market and sell it to ESPN or Fox? They tend to love the BitTorrent brand to begin with, and the sales cycle here can be a little bit longer because of that. So look for this one soon, and hopefully, you know, if the FCC does begin to become a little more favorable for online services and look at a sort of statutory licensing for content rights, everybody's an MVPD at this point, then the game is who can deliver the content for the lowest price. I will pass every bit of those savings on to the consumer, and my content costs are exactly the same as DirecTV's. That would be a very interesting world for us. Okay, that's enough about the other apps that we do. But again, hopefully you see a common theme, right? Decentralized, very few servers, all interested in targeting certain problems that we see on the internet. Hopefully we're leading the way for other application developers to build similar things, because the internet's a very rich place and there's a lot of work yet to be done. Project Maelstrom. So the question that we were inspired by here, obviously the web is the most powerful, or one of the most powerful applications that exists on the internet today. It's a cornucopia of content. And the question we asked ourselves is, what if that content that exists on the web, what if that worked more like the way BitTorrent does, completely distributed? And what if we could render it in a way that anybody could use it? You didn't need to understand what a torrent client was. You didn't need to understand how to get a torrent file into a client or then find it in your file system to view that content. It should just be as seamless as a browsing experience is. So it seemed the perfect opportunity to test that. We took a Chromium fork, and we integrated some technology into that and created Maelstrom. And this is the start page, and you can begin to see immediately the theme that we're talking about here. Every page that exists in Maelstrom can be distributed without a single server. And this has a couple of very interesting properties for us. A, it allows anybody to publish. I don't need to have a domain name. I don't need to have MySQL skills. I can just publish content by ingesting it into my browser, and anybody can browse it as long as it lives in my cache. There are also opportunities for us to look at, you know, other content, and one of the inspirations for it is, you know, all these titles down here were publishers that we had, you know, meticulously cultivated through our Bundles platform. And Bundles is run through a traditional torrent client. Every one of these publishers said, that just doesn't work for my Hollywood friends. They don't know how to use torrents. Can you make it easier? So if we're going to get more content in the torrent ecosystem, more good content, which we want, it needs to be rendered in a platform that everybody knows and knows how to use, and that is a browser. So one more check mark for this one. We tried to create an experience around it that gave users the indication that something different was happening, and you can see it in this graphic as well. You know, the idea that, you know, we're very explicitly telling you that this is kind of a different experience. We're trying to walk people through how to get content through Maelstrom. If you see a magnet link, you should just be able to click it, and hopefully this animated GIF will work. So it happens faster than this. This is PowerPoint bogging down. The animated GIF might not work. But so I'll go back to this. You know, we again tried to articulate some user experience that showed how different this was. It scans the network through the DHT to find peers who can introduce you to other peers who can find you the content. At the end of this, you'll get a big green check mark that says torrents found, and it'll just play. If it's a media file, it'll play. If it's a web page or an HTML file, it'll just render. And the experience here is meant to be completely seamless. So obviously, we're hoping to get more good content in the ecosystem because this experience is so seamless. And we think that'll ultimately be a good thing. But of course, it's also a browser, and it works just like Chrome. And this is the GetSync web page rendered in Maelstrom, just like any other web browser. So it does that too. And down the road, we may begin to integrate other torrent-like capabilities into normal web pages. If we can get around the copyright issues, web pages that you browse may be also rendered back up as torrents through your cache, so that if I'm in a part of the world where censorship is an issue, maybe I can't get it through this domain, but maybe I can get it through the magnet link that's rendered from my cache, things like that. So these were the problems that we were hoping to solve. Again, you know, we wanted to keep the internet as open as possible. Now, narrowly defined in this context, open is that anybody can publish. I think the more people that can publish, the more good content you'll see on the internet, the more powerful the internet will become. That more internet is definitely something we want to see at the end of this day. The internet being neutral is something that, you know, we've obviously been a part of this debate for a while as well. I've had the pleasure of testifying before the FCC on matters of network neutrality, and it's not an easy problem, but technology might have something to say about this, and I'll bring that up in a bit. I've already talked about how we can scale efficiently for content, and we're one of the few protocols that can, but we also want to be able to deliver content in parts of the world where network infrastructure isn't great. And the protocol is quite old. It's, you know, invented in 2001. The internet didn't look anything like the internet does today. So it's proven to work in areas where infrastructure maybe isn't the best. The third world isn't a surprise when you see a lot of BitTorrent usage in places like, China, India, Sub-Saharan Africa. These are all places where BitTorrent usage is on the rise because it works in those areas of the world where infrastructure isn't the best. But at the end of the day, an internet where the end user is in control, this is an internet I want to be a part of. And this is an internet I want to deliver for future generations and users of the internet. So open, I've already mentioned, anybody can publish. I don't need to know how to do anything other than drag a piece of content into the browser, and I've published it. Neutral. So, you know, there's a policy solution here, but of course, there are many jurisdictions in the world, and the internet is a global phenomenon, and any problems that we may or may not solve here in the United States doesn't really help a user in Eastern Europe or a user in some parts of the world where policymakers aren't thinking like this. So we would prefer to see architectural or technological changes baked into the architecture of the internet that delivered on this promise, because neutrality is an important part of future innovation. If the world is walled off to certain innovators, or governments can protect incumbent industries just because, that's not a world where you're going to see a future internet that we want to see. So the big issue that we stumbled into in the last policy debate was, you know, in 2008, it was this guy launching a man-in-the-middle attack against BitTorrent. So that was very clear, and it sparked the appropriate response by all parties. And that practice was stopped, and nobody else tried to engage in it. And I think the maker of that gear, you know, moved on to other solutions. But what we saw recently was the fact that I know content is coming from certain parties that maybe I'm competing with. Netflix maybe is an example. It's coming from very specific pipes, very specific interconnects. And because the internet we have today is a destination-based internet and not necessarily a content-based internet, it's very easy to say, okay, all traffic to that point from this pipe, I can step on that hose and my problem is solved. That's not a neutral internet. Now, you know, we can try to fix that a lot of ways, but what if instead of articulating what could or couldn't be done at the interconnection level, all content was or all addressing was content-based instead of destination-based. So imagine Netflix was all torrents, and it was all coming from other users all over the world, and it was all encrypted, and you didn't know what content was what. That would be a very difficult world to interdict, because you can't stop your own users from sending to each other. You can't stop other ISPs from sending to each other. You have no idea where the traffic is coming from or even what it is. It all looks like bits. They're all encrypted, and they're coming from everywhere. And they're coming from everywhere all at once. And that is the way BitTorrent works. It's a very challenging environment. If more of the internet worked like that, network neutrality might be less of an opportunity for incumbent ISPs to play with very obvious points on the internet that are very easy to game. So this is an opportunity maybe for technology or a new architecture to address a technology or a policy problem. Scale. So we've already talked about this, and this obviously isn't a scale, but you know, the internet I grew up on was lots of images, and well, even before HTML, these are very, very small objects, and the internet worked pretty well. Clearly, this is not to scale. I think if this was one pixel, this would probably be like 1,000 screens up to the top. But as we move into sort of the ultra high definition content genres, the 4Ks and the 8Ks. The problem of content size is going to become a big one. And it's going to become a big one for a couple of reasons. Well, one very important reason. On the edge of the network, you've got this thing called Moore's Law, which is making this possible at an exponential rate. But the network is built on things like backhoes that don't obey Moore's Law. And it's built on union labor that doesn't obey Moore's Law. The network is always going to be constrained because we can never keep up with the way things are happening on the edge of the network. The edge of the network is growing in capability so much faster than the underlying network's ability to deliver it. And this is always going to place a premium on efficient delivery. The more efficiently you can deliver content, that's going to become more and more valuable as we look into the future. Because content isn't going to get smaller. Nothing on the internet has ever gotten smaller. Don't expect it to happen anytime soon, precisely because of this phenomenon. And that means a future for BitTorrent or a BitTorrent-like technology is a bright future. Everybody asks me, my board asks me all the time, why aren't you dead? You know, you've been around 10 years, nothing lasts 10 years, how are you still here? And it's this phenomenon. This phenomenon is not going away. It's an underpinning to the internet as a whole. So that's good news, at least for BitTorrent. So we're not the only ones clearly thinking about some of these things, and I'll just point out some initiatives, and they've gone by various names. I was first introduced to this work maybe 2 or 3 years ago. Nacho from Park invited me to speak in Madrid alongside a bunch of other very senior academics that were thinking about stuff that when I first saw it reminded me of BitTorrent quite a bit. And it was a move away from this destination-based internet, one where I might go to a server and expect that server to give me what I'm interested in. And that's what all of the routing and the DNS does today. It takes me to a place, and that place gives me whatever it's got. And this is akin to going to the library and going to a particular spot on the shelf and grabbing whatever book is there. Now, the library, in a way, is a content address system. Every book has an address. Why doesn't every piece of content on the internet have an address? Now, in BitTorrent, it does. It's a hash, and that uniquely defines every torrent and the content that's in that torrent. Why doesn't more of the internet work like that? And that's what these researchers are thinking about it. I think the latest name might be named data networking or information-centric networking, but very interesting work because what they're trying to do is they're trying to put something that looks like BitTorrent in every node of the network. Now, we can't do that. We're not big enough. I can't make Cisco routers implement the BitTorrent protocol. But if these guys are successful sort of at the IRTF or the IETF level, this might be an interesting future or an interesting future architecture for the internet. This is stuff to watch. Very interesting. Clearly, Maelstrom has some issues today, and we've got a lot of work ahead of us. I'm not going to type this in. These are some photos that I took just before coming here. If you were to type that hash in, you'd be here a while. So we need to find a way to make human-readable names. And it's many, you know, some of the problems are the same here. Name data networking has the same issue. We need a DNS-like thing for content. And I need to have a human-addressable or human-readable way to talk about content on the internet. This clearly isn't human-readable. So there's an opportunity to do this right. If we do DNS again, you won't see a centralized solution from BitTorrent, that I can assure you. So something that does this will be very decentralized in nature, which will introduce its own challenges, and it'll be interesting to see, you know, how that ecosystem evolves. How is Maelstrom going to handle changes, right? So what if I took the entire Wikipedia and I wanted to torrentize it in Maelstrom and I wanted to make it accessible to users in China that might be behind the Great Firewall? How would I handle the way Wikipedia pages change? We've thought about that. We have the ability to mutate torrents. Torrents can change over time. They're mutable torrents. But this may or may not be the right way to handle information and the way it changes on the internet if we're trying to distribute it. So this is an interesting problem we're thinking about as well. Search. This is huge. One of the ways that inspired us is, you know, the way that Google is somewhat frightening in its scope and what it can do and what it can influence. And just with minor changes to the algorithm, they can change world history. That's incredibly powerful, and we think a little too powerful. So we're very interested in ways that we can distribute or democratize search. No idea how to do it. This is a very challenging issue. Objects that live in the DHT, we can clearly search. We're somewhat afraid to do that because in many ways we don't know what's in there. So it's probably some combination of signed torrents where we can sign them and they can be known to be good, or at least we can revoke the certificate if they're not. And then we have the ability to index and search those and make those easily accessible to somebody through a distributed search engine. Big problem for us. Clearly, we're not at all focused on anonymity or conserving or preserving identity. Bleep, you have the ability to be incognito, but your IP address is still your IP address. You're best to use something like Tor or something on top of some of the technologies that we build. We are not a one-stop shop yet for your entire future internet. And of course, we're venture-backed. I have no idea how to fund this. Some of these challenges are many, many years in the making, and your typical VC fund is 10 years and not much more than that. You will turn into a pumpkin if you haven't figured it out by then. The future internet is going to take longer than 10 years to build. So how are we going to fund it? Who's going to do it? I don't think we can expect the venture-backed community to do it for us. They're going to build us Google because it's profitable. If we want the internet to be the internet we want, big problem. How do we fund it? How do we solve it? How do we build it? I don't have an answer. But the stuff that we have built does begin to look a little bit like this. It is more open, it is more neutral, and it is more scalable. And perhaps with this small example that we've painted for the world, we can begin to build an internet that kind of looked like the one we had, but not maybe the one we have right now. And that's all I have for you guys. Thank you.